In this video, I will show you how rpackage GGIR is used. To get started, we first have to download and install R and RStudio, which are freely available for Linux, Windows and Mac. Once R has been installed, the GGIR package can simply be installed from the toolbar. But we have already installed it, so we do not have to do that now. Now we can start working on the accelerometer data. Copy the raw data files into the dedicated folder. The name of this folder will be used as study name in the reports that are generated by GGIR. In this case, our folder name is simply data. GGIR comes with one shell function that allows you to interact with all the functionality GGIR has to offer. The shell function is called g.shell.ggir. This function accepts a lot of input arguments that relate to all the functionalities of the package. In this tutorial, I only will highlight and explain a few of them. What you see here is an example script for using the shell function. You can find a copy of this in the package vignette. The lines represent the function arguments. If you remove a line, the default argument value is assumed. GGIR is structured in 5 parts. Part 1 loads the raw data and aggregates them to epoch-level summary metrics. Here, with argument window sizes, you can specify the length of an epoch in seconds, but also the length of the time windows used for the non-wear detection. With argument do.cal, you can specify whether GGIR should try to improve the calibration of the data relative to gravitational acceleration. This is done by default, and I would recommend leaving it that way. The way the data is aggregated can be done with one or multiple metrics, which attempt to separate gravitational and movement-related acceleration. In the background, the output of part 1 and the other parts are stored in milestone files. With argument override, you can specify whether these milestone files need to be overwritten if they already exist, which helps to avoid doing double work. Part 2 then does a generic analysis on the output of part 1. For example, it allows the user to specify which part of the signal can be ignored due to study protocol decisions. For example, there is one argument that allows the user to specify how many hours can be ignored at the start of the recording. Next, part 2 estimates when the accelerometer is not worn and how much valid data there is left after we ignore both types of data loss. Part 3 is primarily a pre-processing step for the sleep analysis in part 4. Here, the code detects time segments during which the accelerometer did not rotate beyond a certain number of degrees for a certain minimal duration, which you specify with these two arguments, so one for the angle and one for the minimum duration in minutes. The default is set to 5 for both, which is based on current evidence the best choice. Part 4 performs the sleep analysis. Here you can, for example, specify whether you would like to rely on a sleep log, also known as sleep diary, to guide the acceleration-based sleep estimates. If so, then the argument log location needs to be specified, with a path to the file in which you have stored the sleep diary. If you do not have a log location, you should comment this out, or just leave it blank. And then the code will automatically try to detect when the sleep period time window occurs. By specifying the argument devnoc-sleep, like I do here, you will make sure that GGIR uses the latest algorithm for sleep period time window detection. Part 5 aims to heuristically segment the measurement in classes of behavior. The number of classes can be configured, but by default it generates these. Finally, GGIR aggregates the output of Part 2, 4 and 5 as CSV reports, both per day of measurement as well as for the full recording. Once all parameters are set, we can start analyzing the raw data using the source button in RStudio. Especially deriving the milestone output from part 1 can take a while. The typical duration of processing an acceleration file with all 5 parts is between 10 and 20 minutes, depending on the specifications of your computer and the duration of the recording you are working with. Often, this only has to be done once. Next time, you could set argument override to false, as I previously explained, to avoid having to process the data twice. Once the processing has finished, we can inspect the output which is stored in an automatically created folder structure. Let's open one of the files. The meaning of all the variables in the CSV reports are explained in the package documentation. Hopefully, this introduction video has helped you to get started with GGIR. For further questions, you can have a look at our online documentation. All relevant links can be found on the GGIR cron site. Our vignette is a good starting point. For more detailed information on the code, there is an extensive manual. You can also join our Google group, which is meant to support users of GGIR. If you have specific bugs or feature requests, then you should report them in the GitHub repository of GGIR. Finally, we also welcome contributors to the software. Please see the README file in the GitHub repository for more information about how you can contribute.